video demonstrates how we can carry out a simple linear regression using Excelstat. Let's take a look at the dataset we have. I'm going to use the same house price example dataset as we discussed in the lecture slides. So there are 24 houses here. We have their respective size, which is measured in thousands of square footage. We also have their corresponding price, which is measured in thousands of dollars. Besides these 24 houses, we also have three more houses. We have their size. We have their sizes, but we don't know the prices for them, and we want to be able to predict using our model. We may think there's a linear relationship between the size of the house versus the price of the house. As the size increases, the price probably also go up. So we're gonna fit a simple linear regression model to this dataset. And let's see how we can do that using Excelstat. Under Excelstat, go to Modeling Data, Linear Regression. I would recommend you to reset the dialog box and choose the variables. So first is a dependent variable, that's your Y, that's going to be the price. Next is going to be X, which is exponential variable, also known as an independent variable. So we try to use the size of the house to predict the price. So X should be the area. Do we have variable labels? Yes, we have area and price, those column headers. Next, options. For options, you can just leave it as it is. You don't have to change anything. Validation, you don't have to check anything either. Prediction, we do want to predict those three houses, and now we have to tell Excelstat those are the values of the house we want to predict. So first, check prediction. X, is it quantitative? Yes, the sizes of the houses are also numerical. So we're going to choose those. Okay. Missing data. So right now, I don't see any missing data, but sometimes there may be missing values. And if that is the case, I would recommend remove the observations. Outputs. Okay. So do we want to have a descriptive statistics of the size and other price? For example, their mean and median, things like that. Yes. I'm going to check that one. Correlation. Do we want to figure out what is the correlation that measures the linear relationship between size versus the price? And typically we want to do that, so I'm going to check it. How about ANOVA test? Yes, we do want to make sure there's ANOVA table being provided. Okay. Standardized coefficients, okay. Prediction and residuals. So this prediction is different from the prediction tab we just checked earlier on. This prediction is for all of the axes here, for those 24 houses we have already have their data. Do we want to predict using our model as well? You can check it. I'm gonna check it here. Great. Charts. Okay. And now you can click on OK. So we have 24 Ys and 24 X, and we want to predict three of them. Continue. Okay, so I'm going to remove the grid lines by clicking on this one. And let's take a look. So for the price, you can move them a little bit bigger to allow you enough space to see all the words here. So 24 houses. 24 houses and their price is ranging from $62,000 all the way to $215,000. The size of the house is ranged from 1.2. This is measuring thousands of square footage. And then the largest one is about 3,000 square footage. So the next one is a correlation matrix. So this is completely symmetric, as you can see, 0.958 appeared twice. This corresponds to about 96%. So that means area and price are highly correlated and also positively correlated. And the next table we have here is going to give us R square and other metrics which measures how good your model fits this data set. So as you can see, R square here is 92%, very close to 92%. This is really high. The next table you see here is the ANOVA table, which describes how well this linear model fits your data set. And so how do we tell whether it's a good model or not? We can take a look at the p-value, which is given right here, 0.0001, which is really, really small. It's actually less than that, so it's almost close to zero. So p-value very, very small. That means you are going to reject the null. And the null says the model is useless. So we are going to reject the null, which says the model is useless. That implies the model is actually very useful in explaining this data set. So our model, when we try to use the size of the house to predict the price of the house, is actually very useful. So the next table we see here, this is going to include all the beta estimates, which has the intercept and also the slope parameter. So they have their corresponding standard errors and also t statistics, their corresponding p-value as well. ExcelStat also writes out an estimated equation for us, which is given here, but there are just too many decimals, and this is not very useful. What I meant is too many digits are not very useful. You probably can run it out. So we can write price is equal to 0.15, 0.12, plus intercept, which is 76. You can also see it here, 76.17. multiply by area of this house. So this is going to be your estimated model. And this is indeed the linear line. As you can see, there's an intercept followed by a slope. So next, you see several graphs plots, which tells you how well this model fits the data. And because we did check a prediction in one of the boxes, so we are going to predict what's going to happen to those 24 houses. We do have data. And so we can see their actual price, which is given here. So in our data set, for example, the first house is 2.1 square thousands of square footage and $150,000. You can check it here, 2.1150. So according to our model, this house should be $144,000, $145,000. So this is the prediction. And so if you do move them a little bit so you can see what's being written down there. So we're going to continue here. And as you can see, a lot of text being covered. So I'm going to teach you another trick. You just click on this row, go to Home, not Excel Stat, but Excel Home tab. Click on Wrap Text so you can see the words more clearly. So there are two different sets of a lower and upper bound. Lower bound and upper bound, this actually has a mean to here to them. And there's also a lower bound and upper bound here. So there are two different sets of intervals. So the first one, lower bound, upper bound with a mean, this is actually represents the confidence interval. Remember, confidence interval is for mean. Whereas if they have observation, that means this is for prediction interval. As you can probably see, the prediction interval, which is 117 to 172, is actually wider than the confidence interval, which is about 140 to 150. So confidence interval is narrower, whereas prediction interval is typically wider. Because confidence interval, you do have to take averages, and then averaging actually reduces variability. On the other hand, if you're doing prediction doesn't take into consideration of averaging, so it has more variability, and that's why the interval is wider. Okay, so let's go down to the very end of this output. We want to take a look at the predictions for those three houses. We try to predict the house with a size about 1,500 square footage, 2,800, 2,200. We have their estimated price, the predicted price according to our model. We also have several other intervals. Again, the words are difficult to see, and I'm going to write them. Okay, so let's take a look. We have two sets of intervals here. I'm going to make them a little bit wider here. Okay, so the first one, which has a mean next to it, so this is going to be 95% confidence interval. So this is going to be 95% confidence interval of the estimated price for each one of those houses. And the second set of interval, this is going to be the 95% prediction interval. So those two are not completely identical. And again, you can see the prediction interval is wider than the confidence interval, just for the same reason I explained earlier. And this concludes this tutorial. Thank you very much for watching.